بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عبس وتولى أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى أما من استغنى فأنت له تصدى وما عليك ألا يزكى وأما من جاءك يسعى وهو يخشى فأنت عنه تلهى كلا إنها تذكرة فمن شاء ذكره في صحف مكرمة مرفوعة مطهرة بأيدي سفرة كرام بررة قتل الإنسان ما أكفره من أي شيء خلقه من نطفة خلقه فقدره ثم السبيل يسره ثم أماته فأقبره ثم إذا شاء أنشره كلا لما يقض ما أمره
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم والحمد لله رب العالمين حمد الشاكرين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Dear brothers and sisters, just a quick reminder that we are going through Tafseer al-Quran according to the revelation of the Surahs. Starting from Surah Iqra, we did Surah Iqra, Al-Alaq, Surah Al-Qalam so far, Al-Muzammil, Al-Muddathir, Al-Fatiha, Al-Masad, Surah Al-Takwir, Al-A'la, Surah Al-Layl, Al-Fajr, Surah Al-Duha, Al-Sharh, Surah Al-Asr, Surah Al-Adiyat, Al-Kawthar, Al-Takathur, Surah Al-Ma'un, Al-Kafirun, Al-Fil, Al-Falaq, الناس الإخلاص. Last time we finished سورة النجم and today we are doing سورة عبس وتولى إن شاء الله. In سورة النجم which we have just concluded, let me just try to do a quick summary here and show the relevance if you will to the سورة that we are doing today. The Surah An-Najm came with specific topics, specific issues that the Surah dealt with. One of them is regarding the Hidayah, the guidance, and that Allah Azza wa Jal started the Surah by swearing or making an oath with the star once it falls down and it collapses and disappears. And the star being a symbol of guidance for the people of Mecca at the time and today. There are the stars which are people, different types of stars, if you will, people, constitutions, presidents, dictators, all types of stars which are used as a form of guidance. And then Allah Azza wa Jal shows that all of this would collapse, would disappear, would no longer be able to give guidance to people. And then the Quran is the final guidance from Allah Azza wa Jalla, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the carrier of the torch of guidance. This one. And then the surah also dealt with vital issues in Mecca like worshipping idols, which are again those idols, they symbolize the man-made guidance, if you will, man-made systems, man-made rules, man-made regulations. And took at Al-Lata wal-Uzza wa Manat al-Thalithat al-Ukhra, and talked also about some of the stars that were used to be worshipped by the people of Mecca and thought of as the ultimate guidance, like Ashara. And also the Surah An-Najm dealt with the with some concepts, how people designate deities, if you will, like in the ayah, إن هي إلا أسماء سميتموها أنتم وآباؤكم ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان. These are just names that you give titles to kings, to presidents, to dictators, to systems, capitalism, nationalism, democracy, tribalism, all of these isms that you are dealing with, and you're thinking that these are the issue, the main guidance of you, the main source of rules and regulations. And then, of course, the Quran dealt with the issue of comparison between certainty and uncertainty, things that are absolutely certain from Allah Azza wa Jal, and things which are really just probabilistic, if you will. Where does the guidance exist? And then eventually, the ayah dealt with the types of categories of people who dominate, let's say the ones who dominate the lives of the people, like today, capitalists, big capitalists, the ones who really think when they give 1% or 2% of some of the things that they own or they gain, and then they think that they have done more than enough, more than they are supposed to be, whereas the rest of the people continue to suffer from poverty and from all types of issues. And so those were the basically the issues that came in Surah An-Najm, and we talked about them at length. Now, an interesting thing which is related to this surah here, Surah Abasa wa Tawalla, before I go into the details, one of the people who accepted Islam and was the son of the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his name is Ubaidah or Utbah ibn Abi Lahab, Utbah the son of Abu Lahab. And of course we know that Abu Lahab was a fierce fighter against Islam and against his nephew Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Him and his wife, they deserved an entire surah in their name or in their title, Abi Abu Lahab. Tabbat yada Abi Lahab wa tabma aghna anhu maluhu wa ma kasab. سيصلى نارا ذات لهب وامرأته حمالة الحطب. All of this, the son of Abu Lahab, Utbah, did accept Islam at some point before the revelation of Surah An-Najm. That's where the issue comes, Surah An-Najm. And when Surah An-Najm was revealed, and Surah An-Najm was very strong surah within the realms of the struggle in Mecca. The struggle here, there is a new idea rising up from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal, which came, which actually ridiculed everything that the society of Mecca was dealing with, worshipping idols, dealing with interest and riba, abusing, and actually taking a very strong negative stand against women when they used to bury their children, especially their daughters alive. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ. We talked about this ayah in previous surahs when we talked about the tafsir in the relevant surah. So the struggle was at its peak, at its height. And on the side of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam were very weak Muslims, very oppressed Muslims, the ones who really, if you will, the poorest, the weakest in the society in general. And the surah, this surah will talk about one incident of this. But what I'm alluding to here is the son of Abu Lahab did accept Islam and was a Muslim until Surah An-Najm came. Surah An-Najm, once it was revealed, as we talked about in the last six series of this surah, it was one of the strongest criticism and attacks to the basic idols and ideas and supreme models, if you will, in Mecca. It was very harsh. And Utbah bin Abi Lahab could not take it. He could not take it. His previous attachments to the relations and the bonds of the society of Mecca, which were the bonds of tribalism, of families, of things that had to do with the with all types of ignorance, if you will, as we call it, the era of Jahiliyyah. It just haunted him again, and he repulsed out of Islam, and he left Islam, and he went back to kufr. That's right after Surah An-Najm. In fact, if the narrations or the stories related to the Mi'raj and the timing of the Mi'raj were accurate, at least in this surah, the aunt of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam reported to him that after the revelation that Muhammad, peace be upon him, was in a journey not only to Al-Quds, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa today, but even to the heavens to meet with all of the angels and the power of this very high, supreme, prestigious level of the godly world, if you will. Many people could not take it. Some of them were Muslims, and they actually repulsed from Islam and left Islam, like Utbah bin Abi Lahab. So, and then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a statement against him. And in this surah, ayah number 17, the Quran alludes to that issue. It says, "Qutila al-insanu ma akfara." Qutila al-insanu ma akfara, like wow, or condemning Allah Azza wa Jal, condemning the person who really insists on kufr. And the according to Al-Qurtubi and Al-Tabari and Ibn Kathir, that this specific ayah number 17 was related to Utbah. So that's one incident that comes immediately after Surah An-Najm, and this shows the concatenation and the attachments between the surahs according to revelation. That's number one. Number two, I want to mention that within the society of Mecca, again, the struggle was at its peak. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so anxious to get some support and power to this da'wah, that this da'wah has been going on for a while now, and the kuffar of Mecca were taking every possible stand against Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They were ridiculing him, they were character assassinating him, they were calling him as-sahir, the magician, as-sha'ir, the poet, al-kahin, the one who steals ideas and thoughts from the previous religions, the one who is insane, as the Surah Al-Qalam, right from the very beginning, says, "Ma anta bi ni'mati rabbika bi majnun." They were telling him that you are insane, and they were going after the people who you started believing in Islam, like Yasir and Sumayya and Ammar, and actually they killed Yasir and Sumayya, and they were going after Bilal radiyallahu an, and they were torturing him. We know all of this story. So there was a very strong, fierce struggle. And within all of these, within all of this environment and this heated environment, if you will, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was insisting that he wants to provide the ultimate strongest support to his followers, to the followers of Islam, so that this group of Muslims, the new group, the rising group of Muslims, the group of change, if you will, the group that was determined with the leadership of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to bring the ultimate light to the society of Mecca and to the rest of the societies in the world, to bring this Islam, this deen of Islam, to the highest possible position, so that the only one who will be worshipped and whose orders will be followed and whose regulations will mean something is Allah Azza wa Jal. That was the goal, that was the objective. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, within all of these difficult times and difficult issues, was hoping that he can win to the side of the da'wah someone with strong power, someone who can support, someone who can protect, someone at least who can put some weight to this da'wah. That was the case. Now, within this environment, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was talking to a group of the elites. Some people claimed it was one of them, Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira, Umayyah bin Khalaf, Amr bin Hisham, who was called Abu Jahl, Al-Akhnas bin Shuraykh, some of those elites. It's a group of people. He was talking to them and he was thinking and believing and hoping that one of them will click, one of them will change, one of them will come along. That was his hope. And he was so involved with this talk and discussions. And of course, now Surah An-Najm has just been revealed, as I said. And in Surah An-Najm, towards the end, the ayah when Allah Azza wa Jal, he asked the people within the ayah to bow down to in the surah, which says, فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَعْبُدُوا, bow down to Allah Azza wa Jal and be firm believers and worshippers, of course, of Allah Azza wa Jal. And the story says that the kuffar of Mecca, they did bow down. They did make ruku', they did make sujood. Whether they liked it or not, whether it was by their will or Allah Azza wa Jal inflected into them the need and the guts to really bow down, it doesn't matter, but it did happen. So that gave Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam a chance or maybe a glimpse of hope that these people, if I follow up with them, if I just talk to them one more time, if I convince them, if I argue with them, if maybe I can win someone. That was the condition. Now, while doing so, a man comes running or hurrying up to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A man who had been a Muslim already. A man under the name of Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum. Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum. The stories narrate that he was blind or at least has some issues with his eyes, with his sight. So that's the condition of the person. So he's a weak person. He's not one of the elites of Mecca, but he's a Muslim. He's a believer. He accepted Islam when the other people rejected it. He accepted the call of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal as the only Rabb, as the only God, as the only sustainer, as the only king, as the only. He believed in that. And he was a strong believer. And he's, every time there is a new surah, there is a new ayah that is revealed, he is one of those early Muslims who would rush to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to learn. I want to know what has come from Allah Azza wa Jal. I want to know the surah. There was a surah that has just been revealed, An-Najmi Idha Hawa. Maybe he did not hear it all, he did not listen to it all, but definitely he knows Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has all the wahi. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had all the contacts with Allah Azza wa Jal through Jibreel alayhi salam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, he has that link. That link is always ready with Muhammad. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam always has something to give, something to teach, something that we can grasp from, something that we can acquire. And here comes Abdullah bin Ami ibn Ummi Maktoum. He's the son of the mother of Maktoum. That's the name, Abdullah, the son of who is his mother? Ummi Maktoum. Ummi Maktoum is from the tribe of Makhzoum, which is the same tribe as Abu Jahl. And this tribe, one of the biggest tribes in Mecca, but nevertheless, he is weak, he's blind, he's poor, he's not rich, he's not one of those powerful, he's not one of the elites who were sitting with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, Muhammad, peace be upon him, while being indulged with the da'wah at its highest level, with the da'wah, with the biggest hope that I will get someone who will actually support and protect people like Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum, will protect people like Yasir and Sumayya and Ammar and Bilal and Suhaib and all of these people who were really abused and persecuted by the elites of Mecca, by the power of Mecca, by the intelligence apparatus of Mecca, if you will, by the police of Mecca, if you will, by the governments of Mecca, if you will, by all of these systems like what we have today. Those people who carry the dawah, especially those who do not have the biggest support of their tribes or their power or their money, they will always be under persecution. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was indulged in trying to find someone who will provide support to people like Abdullah bin Umm Maktum. That's the gist of the story. So Abdullah bin Umm Maktum comes in and he rushes into the setting where Muhammad, peace be upon him, was busy with whatever I have just said. And was pushy, according to the seerah narration, that he wants to learn. Ya Muhammad, allimni mimma allamaka Allah. Oh Muhammad, teach me something you have just learned from Allah Azza wa Jal. Give me more. I want more. Of course, I want more for myself, for my iman, for my belief. And also, I want more for my da'wah, so that I can teach other people and I do my share of the work. So Abdullah bin Umm Maktum, he was not asking for something extraordinary. He was asking for what was his right, for what he understood from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and from the revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal, that he, as a believer in Allah Azza wa Jal, has the highest weight possible. In akramakum indallahi atqakum, the best among all the people are the ones who are closer to Allah Azza wa Jal with taqwa, the one who would watch for Allah Azza wa Jal all the time and look up for the power and the strength and the mercy and the support of Allah Azza wa Jal. This was Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum. And he was coming to the source that had taught him exactly that. So he came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who taught him, who showed him, there is no difference between a rich and a poor, between a blind and the one who sees, between a weak and a strong, between someone who is elite and someone who is a regular person. There is no difference in Islam. In fact, there is one difference based on the belief. And he does have that belief. So he comes with all the strength of knowledge and power and iman that I have access to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and no one can prevent me from that access. No one, not even the Prophet, not even the Prophet can tell me no. Not even a sheikh, not even a alim, not a scholar, not a government, not anyone. No one can stop between me and the knowledge. No one can stop me between me and the source of wahi. No one can prevent me from coming, entering the door where the wahi and the knowledge and the iman and the faith can be acquired by me. This was Abdullah bin Umm Maktum. That's what he was coming to do. On the other side, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was busy doing the same, doing the da'wah, providing the word, the final word of Allah to the people who need it more. Not who already have it more, but who need it. Now they need it, they need the word, the final word, more than the one who has already acquired the belief. The one who has acquired the belief, he needs the knowledge, the extra knowledge, the more power. This people, they need the tick. It needs to tick into their brains. They need that one final click that moves them from kufr into iman, like Umar radiallahu anhu. One final click with one word with his sister, he moved and he jumped from kufr to iman. One word took Hamza radiallahu anhu. One incident that someone told him, Abu Jahl was just beating your nephew Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for standing up for Allah Azza wa Jal. That clicked in him. That was a click, one click. And he became the lion of Islam. And Umar came the protector, the vanguard of Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was doing exactly what was Abdullah bin Umm Maktum seeking, with one difference. Abdullah bin Umm Maktum wants the knowledge, more knowledge, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants the da'wah to penetrate the hearts of one or two or three more people. So everybody was doing his job. Now, here comes the scenario which Allah Azza wa Jal reveals. Allah, now that's what I have just said. That's my version of the story. That's how I narrated it. Because my heart is attached with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't dare talk or mention negativity about the status and the behavior of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam vis-a-vis Abdullah bin Umm Maktum. I don't dare do that. That's my version of the story. That's how I narrate it. That's how I discuss it. Allah Azza wa Jal, He's Allah. He's the God. He's the God of Muhammad. He's the God of Abdullah bin Umm Maktum. He's the God of Quraysh. He's the God of the Arabs. He's the God and the Rabb of America, of Britain, of France, of Hizb al-Tahrir, of Ikhwan, of the Muslims, of the non-Muslims. Allah Azza wa Jal, excuse me. Allah is the one who created all of these. Allah Azza wa Jal does not have specific attachments, specific links to anyone. And we talked about Surah As-Samad a few surahs ago. Those who are following us, when he says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ, unique, As-Samad, absolutely unequivalent, absolutely one, self-sufficient. No links, no attachment. لَمْ يَلِدْ, no children. لَمْ يُولَدْ, no parents. لَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفْوًا أَحَدْ, no equivalent to him whatsoever. So Allah is Allah. Allah is a God. To him, all his creatures are his creatures, including the prophets. So now Allah narrates. Allah says, Allah provides the real vision of the story, starting with Abasa wa tawalla, frowned, talking about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa tawalla, he looks aside. He looks aside. He is avoiding a situation. He is avoiding the man who came rushing to him. Yas'a, an ja'ahu al-a'ma. The a'ma came to him. Subhanallah, subhanallah. Allah Azza wa Jal provides this characteristic or this description, this identification, if you will, of Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum. He doesn't say, an ja'ahu the mu'min, an ja'ahu the knowledge seeker. Came to him a man who had believed in him. Came to him a sahabi. He provides this identification that he was al-a'ma, just to show that there should not be any type of thought or any type of even consideration among Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, leave alone among us, that we get worried or get a little bit annoyed when someone comes with a characteristic that's somehow in the eyes of the society, within the scope of the society, this is a second class citizen. Whether by illness, by shape, by looks, by wealth, by whatever. So Allah Azza wa Jal chose these words on the side of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He showed the emotion, the very inner emotion of the Prophet, Abasa. Abasa is annoyed. He's not necessarily angered, but he's not calm. He's not comfortable. He's discomfortable. He's discomfortable. There is discomfort within him. Abasa wa tawalla. He looks aside. Why? There is a blind man coming. Allah says, the blind came to see him. As if in society of Mecca, there was no one but this person who was blind. There could be many blinds. There could be many blinds all over the world. There could be the big, the small, the whatever character. This is not a way to characterize people. But the situation here, Allah Azza wa Jal wants to overemphasize the situation so that it never repeats. so that we take consideration all the way through that even Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not immune of this type of characterization of the situation, of this type of narration, abasa wa tawalla an ja'ahu al-a'ma, simply because a blind man came to see him. Huma yudrik la'allahu yazakka. What do you know, ya Muhammad? What do you know? Look, Allah Azza wa Jal is not talking about me, which I don't know a lot. He's talking about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, whom are you dreaming? How would you know? How could you guess? How would you know that this very incident, this very encounter of Ibn Ummi Maktum al-A'ma, the blind, is the one that would raise the level of Ibn Ummi Maktum to the highest. Yazakka, it is what we call it in Arabic, sighat mubalagha. It is an extra emphasis on the tazkiyah, means the purification. Yazakka means continuously purifies, continuously being pure, continuously being in the absolute best manner as a Muslim. ما يدريك لعله يزكى. Maybe this very incident is the one that would raise the level of Ibn Ummi Maktum to the highest levels of believers. How could you tell? This could have been his opportunity. Maybe he had come with a very open heart, very open mind, very receptive instruments within him, that this very incident can make it very valuable to him. أو يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. And then he will continuously remember this incident. Had you treated him the way he should have been treated, had you embraced him instead of embracing the talk with the elites of Mecca, maybe this very incident would have remained within the scope of his brain and his emotions and his heart, so that it will always benefit him. فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَ يَذَّكَّر, just like يَذَّكَّر. يَذَّكَّر does not mean يَذْكُر. يَذْكُر means I remember. يَذَّكَّر means keeps remembering. It stays alive within his memory, as we call it in computer systems. It remains in the cache of his brain, always fresh, always ready there. فَتَنْفَعَهُ الذِّكْرَ. That is, in a nutshell, the first 3-4 ayat. عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Finished. We are done with him. Just give him that characteristic to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Was discomforted, a little bit uneasy about it. He frowned emotionally, does not appreciate the situation, turn away his face, continue to talk to the people. On the other side, what's the story? A blind person, without giving any more characterization about him, he's blind, but with coming to the incident, to a case where he is looking for tazkiyah, for purification, for a memory, for a time of life that can benefit him for the rest of his life, on one side. Now, as far as the other one, amma man istaghna, the one who keeps turning away from you. Here is an interesting comparative type of view here. On one side, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turning away from Ibn Ummi Maktum towards these people who he's talking to. But these people, one of them at least, man istaghna, amma man istaghna, but the one who really, he thinks that he doesn't need you. Istaghna means he thinks he's self-sufficient. He doesn't need you. He doesn't need your deen. He doesn't need your God. He doesn't approve of it. He doesn't believe in any of this. This one, فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى. You are facing him. You are trying to catch him. You want to turn your face so that you face him. Tasadda means you are face to face with the guy who is trying to run away from you. To shy away, to turn his face away. So this is the view. On one side, a man is coming to embrace you, to embrace your deen, to embrace your knowledge, to acquire as much as he can. You are turning away from him, but while turning away from him, you are trying to face to face with the kafir, with the mushrik, with the one that you want him to become a Muslim, but he doesn't want to. فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّ وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَّكَّ. Allah Azza wa Jal is bringing, and this is the style of the Quran. Remember, Ibn Umm Maktoum, وَمَا يُدْرِيكَ لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّ. Maybe he will become يَزَّكَّ, means completely purified. And here says, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَّكَّ. And for this guy like Abu Jahl or Al-Walid bin Mughira or Akhras bin Shuraiq or today by today's token, name all the presidents of the world, starting from Biden all the way to someone somewhere in almost nowhere, calls himself a king or a president or a prince. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَّكَّ. Why do you care? Why do you care? If he doesn't want to become a Muslim, he doesn't want to have tazkiyah. Ibn Umm Maktoum wants to have tazkiyah. And that was his chance. And here, you are talking to someone who doesn't want a tazkiyah. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَّكَّ. Same word. لَعَلَّهُ يَزَّكَّ إِبْنُ أُمِّ مَكْتُومٍ. أَلَّا يَزَّكَّ the elites of Mecca. Coming back to إِبْنُ أُمِّ مَكْتُومٍ. وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى. Someone is coming, rushing to you. يَسْعَى means actually, يَسْعَى means just like السعي in الصفا والمروة. We say, السعي, which is almost like running, halfway running, it's like jogging between al-Safa wal-Marwa. That was the official term for al-Safa wal-Marwa. Al-Sa'i. Al-Sa'i means walking or rushing in almost a running phase. So I may not be running, but I am walking so fast as if I was running. We call it sometimes jogging, or in Arabic, al-sa'i. وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى. Very fast, quick, and he's rushing. وَهُوَ يَخْشَى. And he's so internally within his heart, he has this tenderness. يَخْشَى, I'm not going to call it he's afraid. يَخْشَى, sometimes say afraid, scared, but it's not. There is tenderness in his heart. He's absolutely receptive. All his sensors are wide open. He's coming to learn. He's coming to acquire knowledge. He's coming to raise his status, to raise his level in front of Allah Azza wa Jal, to come closer to Allah. يزكى, to be absolutely pure. يذكر, to continuously remember Allah Azza wa Jal. يخشى, absolutely tender, absolutely in a position where he can accept each and every word coming from you. Two pictures. One person, istaghna, doesn't want you. He's rejecting you. He's fighting you. He's fighting your people. He's fighting Ibn Umm Maktoum. He's trying to suppress this dawah, to suppress this Islam. He doesn't, Allah Azza wa Jal talks about these same people in the incident around the Hijrah time, where he says, يَمْكُرُونَ بِكْ. They make makr. They are conspiring against you. لِيَقْتُلُوكَ, to kill you. أَوْ يُثْبِتُوكَ, or to make you drop your deen. أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ, or to evict you. That's what they are doing. That's exactly what they were doing, and Allah Azza wa Jal described that. This is, you are giving him a good face, good, trying to be as nice as possible. And the other one, فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَلَهَّى. You make yourself as if you had not seen him. Now, this is the view. This is the surah. In the midst of a struggle in Mecca, just imagine. Imagine today we are doing all what it takes to bring this dawah up. We need the support of our dawah so badly, so eagerly, not badly, so eagerly. Because we want the rise of this dawah of Islam. We want to achieve the objectives like Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam achieved after migrating to Mecca, to Medina. We want that. And within this, I should be always reminded that the most important element of my dawah are the people who are following me. The most absolutely important. They should have the highest level of priority. Never, never, never underestimate the priority of a person who is following and working with you in this, on the same path of dawah. No matter what the consequences are. No matter. No excuses. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No excuses. Highest priority should have been given to Abdullah ibn Umm Maktoum. Not to Man Istaghna. Not to Al-Walid ibn Mughira. Not to Biden. Not to the president. Not to the king. Not to the officers in the army. Not to the people of power who think they are hofty. They have it. They have everything. And they barely want to talk to you. And even if you talk to them, they will call the mukhabarat for you and the police, and they can arrest you. Highest priority should be given to dawah. Allah in the other places in Surah Al-Kahf says, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ. Stick to the ones who call Allah Azza wa Jal continuously, day and night. Stay with them. These are your power. That's exactly where your power. That's exactly how Allah Azza wa Jal provides you victory, because you remain strongly attached, strongly bonded with the people who follow this path, who follow this deen totally, who are committed to the rise of Islam one more time, as it was Abdullah ibn Maktoum. فَأَنْتَ عَنْهُ تَلَهَا. Don't do that again. Don't play games with Abdullah ibn Maktoum. Just look aside, make yourself busy with something else. Stop. Stop. This is done. Allah Azza wa Jal, He makes a point. He made a point in these first 10 surahs. Okay, done. That's not the issue. Allah Azza wa Jal is not angry with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Azza wa Jal is not mad on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Azza wa Jal does not tell Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you violated my laws or my rules. He's teaching him a lesson. He's directing him to the way he should conduct himself. He is raising his level of morale, the da'wah morale, if you will. His morale is beyond criticism. But there are issues in the da'wah that also have their own ethics and priorities. Stick to the priorities. Keep these priorities up. Never let these priorities go out of your sight. You must keep your priorities. Priority number one is Allah Azza wa Jal and Islam and the Wahi as is. Priority number two, the people who accept Islam and who accept this da'wah and they follow this deen and they are willing to fight and die for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. That's priority number two. وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ بِالْغَدَاتِ وَالْعَشِيِّ وَلَا تَعْدُ عَيْنَاكَ عَنْهُمْ. Never look aside away from them to read زينة الحياة الدنيا for the sake of maybe a worldly issue, something you think you are busy with the da'wah, but for dunya issues. Never do that. Your highest priority is the people who accepted your deen and they believed in the way, in your path, in your deen, in the Islam that you have brought from Allah Azza wa Jal at the time when so many people rejected that, so many people are fighting that, so many people are standing against that, so many people are even fighting and struggling and trying to block the path of the ones who believed in Islam. This is a priority. This is priority, very high priority. Now, putting facts on the table, This is the Quran style. I brought the issue. I talked about the issue. Everybody should take note of it. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum, should also take note of that. Muslims, da'wah carriers, we, everybody around the globe should take note of this type of very strong da'wah. Clean, pure. Tazakka, there is zakah in this da'wah. We got note. Now, talk about now the gist of the da'wah. Kalla innaha tazkira. Now let's put things straight. What is this Islam about? It's tazkira. This is something for the brain. Tazkira is from the word dhikr. And dhikr means memory or memorandum. It is something, tazkira. It is something that can be injected into your brain, into your mind, into your memory, so that it continuously guides you. Because your guidance eventually, yes, of course, Allah Azza wa Jal guides. Yes, of course, the Quran is a guide. Yes, of course, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam provides a guidance. Yes, of course, all of these are facts. But these guidances, eventually, at some point of time, must be injected here. It's not only to guide me by my hand, like the one who was guiding al-A'ma, the blind. This is guidance that goes from inside. إِنَّهَا تَذْكَرَ. This is something that comes to the human, injects itself with the power of the mind into the brain. It becomes part of the continuous, strong, everlasting memory. It remains there. فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَ. فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَ. Whoever wants can use it as a memorandum. فَمَنْ شَاءَ. Whoever. This is open for all, for everyone, from Allah Azza wa Jal. It had come in a form in the Quran, a wahi from Allah Azza wa Jal, and a wahi in the form of a sunnah at the hands of a Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who is absolutely capable and strong enough to carry this da'wah. It has become as a tazkira. So all of it as a memorandum. Tazkira, it's a memorandum. Comes as a memorandum, and a memorandum, as the word implies, it's part of the memory. It sticks to the memory, sticks to the first level of the brain interaction. Whenever the brain wants to take an act and to produce a concept or to take a stand, it consults its tazkira, its memory. فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَ. Anyone who wants, it's open for everyone. Everybody can use it as a memorandum, can make it as part of his own memory, part of his own brain, part of his own mind, part of his own concepts, so that it can guide the person. This is following the Surah An-Najm about guidance. مَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. It is, everything is wahi here. And this memorandum comes in a form of suhuf. It's in writing. It's going to be written as the Quran is today. So it comes as a wahi, comes as a memorandum from Allah Azza wa Jal, then it will be documented في صحف مكرمة. That's documentation. By the way, the issue of documentation in the Quran had been over and over talked about and emphasized. Right from the very beginning, when Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the first surah, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. Read in the name of Allah who created you. خلق الإنسان من علق. He created the human from a clot of blood. اقرأ وربك الأكرم. Allah is the highest honored entity that you can ever imagine. الأكرم. اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم. بالقلم. He wants to teach the people with the use of the pen. Pen is the tool of writing, the tool of documentation. And here he's repeating that this tazkira is not going to vanish as words could disappear and could evaporate with all the time and the efforts and things going around. It will not happen like that, because it's going to be documented in suhuf, fi suhufin mukarrama. And that is a reference, an yearly reference, that this Quran that's just being revealed, we are still doing the surah number 24. We're still at the very early stage of the Quran revelation. Allah says all of this Quran is going to be protected in the highest honored type of pages, of papers, of documents, suhufin mukarrama. Mukarrama, Allah Azza wa Jal honored that. Today, highest honored book in the whole world at any point of time is the Quran. Is this mushaf that carries the Quran within it, whether the people like it or not. And every time someone makes any type of activity, a negative activity towards the Quran, you will find hundreds of millions of people roar across the entire world in support and protection of the Quran. This is the power that Allah Azza wa Jal, this is actually one of the evidences that this Quran could not have been revealed by anyone other than Allah Azza wa Jal, who knows the current and the future all the way through. He says this tazkira is going to be and is currently in suhufin mukarrama, marfu'atin mutahhara. Marfu'a means it's elevated to the highest possible level. Today they talk about a best-selling book, the most read book, the most respected book, the book that received the highest level of prizes. You can never reach a very tiny little portion of where the Quran is. And Allah Azza wa Jal talked about it then. This Quran, في صحف مكرمة مرفوعة مطهرة, it's absolutely pure, purified, heightened to the highest possible level. Today, the Quran is the only book in the world that can be read, and can be memorized, all of it, by people who do not know a single word in it. Not a small poem by Shakespeare or by Chekhov or by any one of these top poets of the world. Show me, find me one person who does not know Russian language, who can repeat one poem of Alexander Pushkin. Show me one person, an Arab, Persian, Pakistani, Afghani, Polish, Romanian, who would know by heart one of the poems of William Shakespeare without knowing English. Show me, just know it, one piece, zero, null, nothing. But there are hundreds of millions of people who memorize the Quran without knowing a single word of it, without knowing a single word about Arabic even, and who would care less about the Arabic language, leave alone about the Arabic people. Especially at this time when the Arab people have deviated away, too much away from what Allah Azza wa Jal wanted them to be. That's the level of the Quran that Allah Azza wa Jal talks about it right here, right at the very beginning. Right at the time when reading the Quran loud was not allowed in Mecca. At the time when propagating Quran to your own people who believed in it was not easy. Here Ibn Maktoum was coming to get maybe three or four or five ayat from Al-Quran. Could not. And the people who were hiding in Mecca, they could not even know what was being revealed. This was the time when the Quran was not making it yet. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not victorious yet, and Islam was not at the highest level yet, except ideologically, from the perspective of idea. Here Allah Azza wa Jal says, this Quran that Ibn Maktoum is coming to do, it is a tafkara, it's a memorandum. And it's open for anyone who wants that. And it is included and documented in suhuf. Suhuf means pieces of paper. Mukarrama, absolutely honored. مرفوعة, heightened, very high level, مطهرة, purified. It's honorable. It's heightened. It's pure. بأيدي سفرة. Now, here the ayah, some tafsir says, مرفوعة, مطهرة, مكرمة, honored, protected, heightened, purified. Some of the tafsir, it says, بأيدي سفرة means by the hands. سفرة means like ambassadors. سفير, سفرة is a plural of سفير. سفير is ambassador, carrier. Ambassador means is the one who carries a task or a message from one to another. So for the angels like Jibril alayhi salam, yes, true. He was carrying this Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's an ambassador, he's Safir. But here, the Quran is talking yet beyond that. It's not only one Safir, one ambassador, Safara, Sufara, ambassadors, people, entities, multitude. Doesn't give number, just keeps it this vague. It could be 1 million, 2 millions, 1 billion, 2 billions, it could be 100 millions, it could be as large as possible. They are carrying it. بأيدي سفرة, the ones who protect this Quran, the one who heighten the Quran, the one who raise the level of the Quran, the ones who purify the Quran, the ones who protect the integrity of the Quran, the ones who keep the Quran at the highest possible level, the ones who fight for this Quran to be implemented, the ones who fight and struggle to make sure that the Quran is absolutely followed all over the world, the rules and the thoughts and the concepts and the regulations and the laws and the constitutions that come out of the Quran should be supreme, should be the highest. These are safara. These are the ambassadors of Allah Azza wa Jal through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In fact, about this, Allah in Surah Al-An'am, He talks about the role of us carrying this da'wah, carrying this Islam, and the responsibility of us is as much as it is the responsibility of the prophets. It says, فَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَنَسْأَلَنَّ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. We will hold questionable and we will hold responsible the ones whom we gave the message. الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. We gave the message to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We gave the message to Musa, to Isa, to Ibrahim. They will be questioned. They will be held responsible. But also will be held responsible the ones who accepted this message. الَّذِينَ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. The ones who accepted this message, because it's our role now and responsibility to carry through. So we are also the ambassadors. Jibril alayhi salam was one of the ambassadors. True. Mufassirin were right. He is an ambassador of Allah Azza wa Jal to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is ambassador to the people like Abdullah ibn Maktoum as much as it is for Al-Walid ibn Al-Mughira. He is ambassador for Abu Bakr as much as it is to Bilal. He is ambassador to Umar as much as he was ambassador to Yasir and Sumayya. And today, we are ambassadors by the very fact that we believed in all of this message to the rest of the people, to the people who accepted Islam and don't know what Islam is about, the ones who believe in Islam and don't know their responsibility towards Islam, and we are ambassadors to carry this Islam to people who do not know it. So this Quran, this tazkira, fi suhufin mukarrama, honorable pages, books, marfu'a, heightened, mutahara, purified, بأيدي سفرة, with the hands of people like me and you. Today, well, I'm talking about today, I'm not talking about yesterday. Today it's بأيدي سفرة, we are the سفرة. We are the ones who are responsible for this. And if the Quran, something happens to it, it's not in the highest position it should be. If it's not being implemented, if it's not being used, if it's being put on the shelves just to read it for people who die, we are responsible for it. We are the sufferer. We are the ones who should make it absolutely honored, protected, purified, heightened, the highest possible level. Nothing should compare to the Quran when it comes to constitutions. People should never adopt any law from any other source other than the Quran. It should not. And the ones who are going to carry that, safara, kiramin barara. Kiram means they themselves should be honorable as much as the Quran. You can't be a person without honor and you carry the Quran. A person who is drunken 24 hours and carry the Quran. People drugged and carry the Quran. People oppresses the people, kills people, persecutes people, put them in jail for nothing but for their Islam, to and then to carry the Quran and talks about it. Kings who make prints today, printing the this print of the Quran had been honored by the His Majesty, the King of blah 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 blah. Can't be. This Quran cannot be honored by someone who doesn't carry honor in himself. He has to be Kareem. Here is Allah Azza wa Jalla says, this has to be done by aidi safara, at the hands of safara, ambassadors, people who carry this message, who carry this da'wah, kiram. They should be kiram. They should be honorable. They should be honored by the same Quran. They should be honored by the words of the Quran. They should be honored by the ayat of the Quran. They should be honored by the light of the Quran. They should be honored by the honor of the Quran. They should be honored by this very great message of the Quran. That's how we become kiram. Barara means we fulfill the message. Al-bar is the one who fulfills his duty. Barara is the plural of bar or abrar. And bar and bir is the one who is up to the responsibility. He's up to his duty. He's up to the task that he's being charged with. That's what al-bar, that's what al-barara. So it's kiram barara, kiram heightened, honored, purified by the Quran, and they are up to it. They are up to it. They are able, and they do it, and they don't stand short of fulfilling this message, of carrying this message, of standing up for this Quran. This is the essence now, what Allah Azza wa Jal is saying about this Islam, about this Quran, that Ibn Maktoum came to listen to and to understand and to carry. Says, okay, let me tell you what it is. It is indeed a tazkira. It is indeed open for anyone who wants to deploy it within himself. And it's indeed, it's going to be protected in paper format, in suhuf. It is indeed, it's going to be honored. It's indeed going to be heightened. It's indeed going to be purified. And it should be done by on the hands of people who are up to it, who can become ambassadors, who can become da'wah carriers, who can carry this spear of Islam, who can raise up the level of the Quran and keep it up as it should be. And they should be kiram, honor themselves, and should fulfill their promises. Now, with this point, Allah Azza wa Jal turns to the reason that this surah, one of the incidents that happened at the time when this surah was revealed, or between this surah and the surah An-Najm, قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ, this is a word Allah Azza wa Jal says, قُتِلَ means death be. It's a term of condemnation. It's not a term of persecution. It's not a death penalty. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. In Surah Al-Muddathir, Allah Azza wa Jal mentioned the same thing. إِنَّهُ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ, about Al-Walid bin Mughira, he thought, وَقَدَّرَ, he estimated what to say to the people about the Quran when they come to ask him. قُد فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ ثُمَّ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ, and then he thought again, and then he estimated again, and then it says, فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. قُتِلَ, and it says, condemned the way he arrived at a thought. This thought he arrived at was absolutely unacceptable. That's the word qutila. In it's a phrase used in Arabic and used in the Quran sometimes to indicate this is a very, very serious act. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. How much kufr this insan can do. And here, although it's in a general term about any insan, but it refers to Utbah bin Abi Lahab, who rejected Islam. And that's at least what al-Mufassirin Qurtubi and some others, they refer to this incident, that this was Utbah who just rejected Islam only one surah earlier, Surah Al-Najm. قُتِلَ الْإِنسَانُ مَا أَكْفَرَ. How much kufr a human can carry on his back. مِنْ أَيِّ شَيْءٍ خَلَقَ. Look, why would you even commit kufr? Look at how you were created. What type of haughtiness you may have. What type of mentality you can think if you know exactly how you came into this life. You came into this life from a sperm being injected in the womb of a mother. Very tiny little, not even a complete cell. It's a half cell. Joins another cell and then Allah Azza wa Jal qaddara. Then he estimated all of this and he perfected all of this. خلق من نطفة خلقه فقدر ثم السبيل يسر. Then he showed you the best path how to live in this world. He gave you messengers, he gave you books, he gave you systems to follow. ثم أماته فأقبر. Then he ends your life at the time when Allah Azza wa Jal wishes. And he orders you to be buried in a grave. ثم أماته فأقبر. Look at this. The only creatures that Allah Azza wa Jal created that we know of who understand what a grave means is the ones that Allah Azza wa Jal guided. Otherwise, you could have been dead and thrown out in the garbage just like any cat or animal or dog once they die. Allah Azza wa Jal made sure that you get honored even in your grave. فَأَمَاتَهُ ثُمَّ أَمَاتَهُ فَأَقْبَرَ ثم إذا شاء أنشره. And the moment Allah Azza wa Jal wants you back, you will come back to him. كلا لما يقضي ما أمره. And this person, he lives, he dies, he goes to grave, he comes up out of the grave, and you have not done the duties that you were supposed to do. كلا لما يقضي ما أمره. This last portion, I decided to bring it up directly with this session, although I will join it again, start with it next time we do the continue the tafsir. Inshallah, I will again dwell on these points, but here I wanted to bring this up because it was related to an incident that happened right before the revelation of Surah Abasa wa Tawalla. So Allah Azza wa Jal brought it up here so that within the realm of this surah that flows as if it is talking about one incident, in reality it talks about a terrain of things. The style of the Quran, the power of the Quran, the greatness of the Quran. May Allah Azza wa Jal guide us to really understand this Quran very well and to be as-safara, ambassadors, to be al-kiram, al-barara, who carry up the message of the Quran and the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to its highest level, to make it absolutely mukarrama, absolutely honored by its implementation in the real life of the world, and to be marfu'a, to be heightened higher than any other system, any other source of legislation and regulation and laws and conducts anywhere in the world. Mutahhara, that's absolutely pure. Nothing should ever come and distort this Quran. May Allah Azza wa Jal give us the reward and give you all the reward for listening and for propagating and discussing these tafsir to the people as much as you can and we can. واستغفر الله العظيم يا الله عز وجل. Give us the forgiveness, and I will stop right here and open the floor for any questions or comments you may have. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Okay. Alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah. There is a question. How can we combine this incident with ayah which talks about best akhlaq? Now, the ayah that Allah Azza wa Jal says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah Al-Qalam, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You are absolutely on the with the greatest moral. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is indeed with the greatest moral, even during this incident. However, Allah Azza wa Jal in this surah, he did not condemn or criticize the moral or the ethics of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He just gave him the a reminder of the priorities. Priorities. Yes, indeed, he was with the absolutely greatest moral and ethics when he was talking, trying to invite other people into Islam, and he did not even mention any word, at least based on the ayah, to Ibn Ummi Maktoum to tell him something that was out of moral or out of order. He just looked aside to continue doing whatever he wanted to continue, but nevertheless, the Quran came and said this, the priorities in this case were flipped. So you chose the priority of inviting the elite of Mecca over the priority of giving knowledge and teachings and the new thoughts and concepts of Islam to Ibn Ummi Maktoum. So this is what we call Khilaful Awla in the issue of fiqh and Islam. It is not the proper priority. And the prioritizing in itself is a concept that came with this incident to teach us. Not only the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could have been told the priorities in a separate incident directly through Jibreel to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, reminding him about an issue. But here Allah Azza wa Jal put it in the Quran in a manner that it's read until the day of judgment, so that the concept of putting things in the correct priority remains valid for all of us. But this is not an ethical issue. It's not an issue of ethics or moral. It's an issue of the priorities, which priority comes first. Question by Brother Riyad John. The last 100 years, people died without understanding Allah as a Rabb, and nobody explains that as I know. Well, the first part is true. Many people have died for many other arbab other than Allah Azza wa Jal, either for nationalism or regionalism or for wars and fights that were created and initiated by America or Britain or France, whether it's with real enemies outside Islam or between Muslims. True, but it's not true that no one had explained Allah, the concept of Rabb as it should, it had been explained, and groups and scholars, many people have died and spent up their life for this very issue of Rabb. Whether it's there are so many brothers who have been persecuted in Iraq, in Tashkent, in Damascus, in Amman, in Riyadh, in Karachi, in Islamabad, in Tunis, Morocco, many other, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, many other in Turkey, for no reason, but for the people, for those people, because they are saying, Rabbi Allah, we want to let the people understand that Allah is our Rabb, and we must make him Rabb. An interesting story that I always remember, I quote, and there are thousands of stories like it, but this one stands tall. When Sayyid Qutb, may Allah Azza wa Jal bless him, was taken out from his cell for his final moment to be executed by, and to hang him actually in Egypt at the time of Abdul Nasser, 1966, they sent him the Mufti or some scholar or sheikh of the Azhar or the Awqaf ministry in order to ask Sayyid Qutb to say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah before he dies. And the interesting, which is a report now by some people who listened to the story, said that Sayyid Qutb mentioned to that person, true, I will say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, I have said it all the time, but there is a big difference between me and you. I am currently going to my death. I am dying for this world to make sure that Allah is the only God who is worshipped and the only Rabb who is obeyed, while you are using this word, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, as a means of to get your salary, as a job. This is your job that you eat and you live well. I use this word as something that I live for and die for. So there are many people, alhamdulillah, these days who are really carrying this task and pushing as much as possible. May Allah Azza wa Jal grant them the victory and the support, so that indeed Allah Azza wa Jal remains the one and only one Rabb for all the people in all aspects of their lives. But thanks for the question. Yes, Abdullah says, for Ayah 15, almost all the translations say, by the hand of messenger angels. Can you explain that? Yes, these are the translations. They usually take word by word translation with some the best knowledge of the translator. But the Ayah is general. It talks, now we know that the Quran was revealed as narration, okay? But here the ayah talks about the Quran being put in a format, in a suhuf, so it's being written, and here the ayah talks about the writing of the Quran, does not talk about the revelation, although some of the tafsir, they talked about that this Quran was revealed by honorable angels, which is true. That's it was revealed by Jibril, the most honorable angel, and maybe before Jibril, if Quran was ever revealed by anyone other than Jibril, we don't have information. At least this has not been reported, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ever received any wahi through other than Jibreel. So it's, to the best of my knowledge, it's one. But this ayah talks about many, and it talks about bi'aydi safara, at the hand of ambassadors, and it talks about really the position of the Quran. So that's the meaning I chose out of all the meanings, because this meaning really reflects the reality today and then. See, if you read at least in Arabic, away from the tafsir, it says this tazkira, which is the Quran, it is in suhuf. Suhuf means in book format or pages, suhuf. It is mukarrama, honorable or honored, marfu'a, heightened, mutahara, purified, at the hand of, bi'aydi, it says at the hand of, at the hand of safara. My own understanding, and I, my knowledge may not be beyond, above and beyond anything that can be disputed. The fact that this whole issue was given in lieu of someone was coming to learn and to take and to acquire part of the Quran that's being revealed. This ayah could indirectly allude to that issue, that this man that we just turned our faces away from him could have been, or could be, or most likely he's one of those who is going to carry this Quran and use it and teach it. And in fact, Abdullah ibn Maktoum, later on, even during the era of Medina Munawwara, was one of the people who was with very great knowledge. And people used to come to him to ask him questions and to find all types of solutions. It may allude to him, but Allah Azza wa Jal puts it in more general term. So there's nothing that says it cannot be the angels, but it's not restricted to them. The ayah is general enough to include anyone who can take the Quran and move it all the way. And thank you for the question. Okay, Jazakum Allahu khairan. I will meet with you inshallah next week. May Allah Azza wa Jal enable us to do that, so we can continue this surah and move on in our tafsirs according to the revelation of the Quran. Jazakallahu khair. Thank you very much, brothers Faizan and his family and the rest of the people who make this happen, and for all the brothers and sisters who participate with us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.